So we'll be learning about basic concepts of object-oriented programming. In today's world, object-oriented programming is a very common name in programming circles. In this chapter, you'll be learning about basic concepts that are used in object-oriented programming, or OOP as we say in short. We'll also be describing about various benefits that OOPs provides over other programming languages. And finally, we'll be discussing about the programming applications of OOPs. So first and foremost, let's understand what is object-oriented programming. First and foremost, it is definitely a tool that helps to increase programmers' productivity. It helps to manage the increasing size and complexity of the program. We all know that if we want a better productivity, if we want a program to be user friendly, including more and more options, then the program becomes more and more complex. So to manage these complex programs, object-oriented programming helps a lot. For example, in nowadays we have C++, we have Java, all the Python, all these are object-oriented languages. If I talk about object-oriented programming in general terms, then we have data and member functions grouped into a single unit. We call it an object. So you will be working with multiple objects in a single program. Each object will be a unique entity in its own, will be reflected by, will be processed by its own data. That data can be processed only by its own member functions. That is how the object-oriented programming works. Every object is an independent entity and is used to define a particular thing or an object or a person with its unique features and the methods that are used to define those features. So this is about the paradigm of OOPs. Then we have features of object-oriented programming. There are various features that are associated with object-oriented programming. Each OOPs has an object, classes. We'll be talking about data abstraction, data encapsulation, data hiding, inheritance, and finally polymorphism. All these are constituting as the basic features of OOPs. We'll be covering all these features one by one. First, we'll talk about objects. An object is a class variable. Till now, you have done programming in C++, you all know what is a variable. So an object is a variable of a class or an instance of a class. It can represent a person, a bank account, an item, anything that a program is supposed to handle, is supposed to maintain record of. When a program is executed, the object interacts by sending messages to one another. These messages are sent using the various functions that are defined in the classes. So when I create an object as an instance of a class, those functions are automatically available for the object to be used. Each object contains data and code to manipulate that data. When I talk about code here, I'm talking about functions that are defined in that particular class, which the object can use. A data can be accessed only and only by those functions of the class. Objects can interact without having to know details of each other's data or code. That is the essence of OOPs. Each object that I create need not know what the other object is having. It can interact with its data using its own functions. And it is sufficient to know just the type of message accepted, type of response returned by the object. Each object, as I told before, is independent of each other. I need not know any other detail about that object. As you can see in this particular figure, customer and account are shown as two objects. These two objects are programmed. The customer object may send message to accounts object requesting for a bank balance, but in its own, a customer is an independent object having its own features like customer ID, customer name, customer address, and so on. Similarly, account is another object which is maintaining the minimum balance or the daily withdrawals or the deposits. Those are the features of the accounts objects. So these two objects can feature independently, can work independently, although they can send messages to each other, can interact with each other requesting for a particular data. This is how an object works in a programming language. After talking about objects, we talk about classes. A class is a user-defined data type. It contains a set of data and a code. A code means a function or a set of functions which help to work with that data. Objects are, as I told before, are variables of type class, or they are instances of classes. Once a class has been defined, we can create any number of objects associated with that class. Each object is given its own memory location. Each object is independent of each other. So, in spite of being created out of the same class, being the variables of the same class, still they are an entity in its own. As you can see, a structure of a class consists of the class name. It consists of the variables or the data that I want to store in that particular class and the functions. For example, if I want to store the record of students, then the class name can be student, the variables can be roll number, name, marks, address, date of birth and so on. And functions can be to accept this data. See, I want to accept roll number, I want to accept name, date of birth and all from the student. And I want to display, or I want to calculate the percentage and then display. So these will be the member functions of this class. So I can access the data items only through these functions, not through anywhere else. This figure shows you an example of a class employee, and you can see the various objects created out of the same class employee. All these objects are the people working in that particular organization. They all are having common features, like each employee will be having a name, an ID, an address, the date of joining, his salary and so on, right? So in spite of the class being same employee, having different features, yet all the objects are having different values of those particular data members. So this is what is the representation of a class. In this example, it is the employee class, and various objects of class employee, Bill, Sue, Hall and all these are shown as the various objects of class employee. Next feature of object-oriented programming is data abstraction. Again, a very, very important feature. It is the act of representing essential features without including the background details. If, say, as the slide shows you, the picture of a switchboard. We all have seen this switchboard. We all have been working with this switchboard. If I want to switch on a particular appliance, I just press the button to switch on or to switch off. How does that work? How by switching on a fan starts rotating, or the light, tube light gets on? That is not known to us. That is hidden to us. What is known is just the switchboard. By pressing down, it is switching on the fan. By pressing up, it is switching off the fan. So this is what is data abstraction. Representing only the essential feature, that means the switch, and hiding the background details. That means the circuitry behind the switchboard which connects the fan so that this fan gets on is not shown to us. Similarly, when I talk about object-oriented programming, as a programmer, I will give access to only that much data that a particular user required. How that data gets converted into output, I am not bothered. The user is not bothered about it. The user is not shown those background details. This is what is data abstraction. We move on to data encapsulation. As the word says, encapsulation means combining into a single unit. So this is one of the most basic concepts of OOPs. It is the way of combining or wrapping up both data and functions that operate on that data into a single unit. I've been talking about classes. I've been telling you that a class is containing data, and that data can be worked upon only by the member functions of that particular class. So a class is containing both data and member functions. So when I'm combining this data and functions which is operating on that data into a single unit, that is the class. This particular feature is data encapsulation. The only way to access the data is by the member functions. If I have created a class student and the member data member in that particular class student is roll number, I can access that roll number only and only through the member functions of that very class. I cannot access that roll number outside the class. So this is what is encapsulation. The data is hidden, so it is considered as safe and far away from accidental alteration. Obviously, I was giving you the example of the switchboard, the inside circuitry, the wiring and all is hidden from the user. So he cannot tamper with that. That is why my data is safe when I am implementing data encapsulation using classes. As you can see in this particular diagram, the item the class by the name of item is shown. It is containing a data member keep data, and it is also containing two member functions, set function and get value function. So this keep data can be accepted, displayed, manipulated. Usage in any form can only be through the set function or get value function. So I have encapsulated the data, that is the keep data variable, and the member functions associated with that data, that is the set function and get value function, into a single unit called class. This is what is data encapsulation. So this is what is the explanation of the figure. The item is class, which has keep data as a data member, and it can be accessed only through the member functions, that is set and get value function. Another concept that is coming along with data encapsulation is data hiding. We have talked about it. I am hiding the internal data structure of the object from the rest of the program. I don't want to give access of certain amount of data to any user or any other part of the program for any reason whatsoever, maybe maybe security reasons or maybe implementation problems, whatever may be the reason. The property in which the internal data structure of an object is hidden from the rest of the program is data hiding. So data encapsulation actually is implementing data hiding. It is a manner in which data hiding is actually done using classes by combining the data and the associated functions into a single entity called class. Next, we move on to inheritance. Another very, very important concept, one of the major advantages of OOPS is inheritance. It is the process by which object of one class inherits the properties of object of another class. As you can see that by using this feature, I am able to reuse a part of a code. If I have created one class and I want certain other classes in which some data is being repeated, so I can inherit those data from that particular class. It also defines the hierarchical classification of classes, and it is the capability to define a new class in terms of existing class. The next slide will show you the example also. The existing class is known as the base class, and the new class is the derived class. For example, if I take the example, I talk about the example here, you have a class called automobile. A bus is an automobile, a two-wheeler is an automobile. So there are certain properties which are common that I put in an automobile class, and the different properties I take in a derived class, that can be a bus, a car or a two-wheeler, anything. So using inheritance, we can build generic base classes. That means we can obtain a new class by adding some new features to an existing class. Like I said, An automobile is one class, say suppose engine, the horsepower of an engine, the number of wheels, these are present in all automobiles. But if I talk about the different properties, then the two-wheeler has some different properties, a car has some different properties. So, those will be coming in the derived classes. Every new class defined in that way consists of features of both the classes. Means a derived class will contain features of the base class, which will be common to all derived classes, as well as it will contain features of its own class, which will be unique to its own class. It allows existing classes to be adapted to new applications without the need for modification. So, I am not coding for the same properties again and again. I have just put the program once, I have just coded once, and those properties can be inherited, can be used by multiple classes which are derived from the base classes. As this example shows that the automotive, there are attributes like engine, number of wheels. Then two-wheeler has some different properties, three-wheelers has some different properties, four-wheelers have some different properties. So, a class called two-wheelers, which is being inherited from automobile, will have the common attributes that the base class is having and some unique attributes that only a two-wheeler has. So, this particular generic classification is shown in this example, in this slide, where if I talk about the topmost class, automotive, it is the base class. It has three derived classes, two-wheelers, three-wheelers and four-wheelers. Two-wheelers further has two derived classes, scooter and motorcycle. So, a two-wheeler is a base class for scooter and motorcycle, whereas it is a derived class for the automotive class. Similarly, four-wheeler is the base class for bus, truck and car, whereas it is the derived class for the automotive class. So, this is how the inheritance hierarchy works. You will be learning about inheritance in the further chapters where this concept will be much more clear to you. Then we move on to next concept, that is polymorphism. Polymorphism is again a very powerful tool of object-oriented programming. It is the concept that supports the capability of data to be processed in more than one form. Same data, same set of data is processed, is used in more than one form. That is how the name goes, polymorphism, where poly is many and morph is form. So, that is how the name, the term has been derived from this particular meaning that comes out. The examples can be operator overloading. You must have seen that the operator plus can be used to add two numbers. But when you will go into programming, this very operator behaves differently when I don't give it numbers, but I give it strings or a set of characters. If I give numbers, it will add it. If I give set of characters, it will append it, means it will add one after the another. So, the behavior depends on the type of data that is used in the operation. It will be further clear from this particular example. If there are numbers, say 3 plus 9, it will give you sum. If there are strings, say my and book, then it will give you my book. So, that is how it is behaving differently with numbers, where it is adding, it is doing the addition operation. With strings, where it is appending or concatenating the strings. Concatenating means adding one after the another. So, if I give two strings, my and book, it will concatenate, it will add the two strings together and it will show as my book without any space. So, after learning various features of object-oriented programming, we come on to the benefits of object-oriented programming. Why is that so that it is becoming so popular these days? Why every programming language is using the concepts of object-oriented programming? It is reducing the software complexity. It can be easily managed as all objects are independent of each other. Because of inheritance, the program reusability increases. So, the software complexity also decreases. Then object-oriented systems can be easily upgraded. If I want to add some more features, I may simply modify the class. I need not modify rest of the program. Modification in class will help me in that. So they are very easy to be upgraded, to be edited, to be used in various forms because of polymorphism concepts. So this is another a very big advantage of object-oriented programming. It is quite easy to partition the work in a project based on objects because different modules can be formed. Each object can be given to a different person to develop as a program, and then we can combine them together. Objects created for object-oriented program can be reused. Inheritance is a classic example of that. I am increasing reusability because of inheritance. Because of various advantages or benefits that object-oriented programming offers, it is being used at various places in programming applications. Some of the applications we'll be discussing here in multiple data structures. That means same data structure is being used many times. For example, a window data structure is used multiple times in a windowing system. You must be having multiple windows on your screen. You are opening the Windows Explorer also. The audio file is also running simultaneously. You might be seeing pictures using or editing pictures using Photoshop also simultaneously. So multiple data structures can be handled in Windows environment. Then you have data in multiple programs. Same operations are performed on a data structure in different programs. For example, a record validation in an accounting system is being done simultaneously when I'm entering the data in my database. Other application areas, parallel programming, where the multiple jobs are being executed by the processor. Simulation and modeling. Artificial intelligence and expert systems, neural networks and design systems, CADs, design systems, and object-oriented database. So all these are applications of object-oriented programming that are being used in software world, software companies nowadays. So coming to the end of the session, we'll just have a quick snap at what all we studied. We studied about basic concepts used in object-oriented programming. We also studied about various benefits provided by object-oriented programming and also discussed various programming applications of object-oriented programming. I hope you got an insight of what object-oriented programming is and the session was helpful for you. Thank you.